In this variation of insoluble salts, we talk about how we determine whether or not we will get precipitation when we carry out a double replacement reaction. So in first semester chemistry, when you carry out a double replacement reaction, we could predict precipitation using solubility rules. But it turns out that even if we predict a precipitate to form, depending on how much concentration of our reactants we use, we might not get precipitation. To determine whether we'll actually get precipitation or not, we are going to use our Q versus K relationships. As our practice problem on the next screen, we are going to predict the products when we add HCl to lead to nitrate. So we'll go ahead and write this equation now. Again, using a completion arrow, I have a strong acid that's going to force this reaction to go to completion. And so our products are going to be PbCl2. Again, we write our product formulas based on charges and nitric acid. And then we would use our solubility rules to predict physical states where we predict that PbCl2 is going to precipitate out. And of course, nitric acid is an acid. And then of course, our last step would be to balance our equation. So we're going to work with this reaction on the next slide as an example. But we want to start by describing the three possibilities of Q versus K. So remember, K is the constant for a given reaction, for an equilibrium system. At a given temperature, again, with temperatures, that greatly affects the solubility. So we are assuming we're working with room temperature for all of these. And then Q will change based on concentrations. So we have our same three scenarios we had when we introduced Q versus K in chapter 13. We could solve and determine that given our concentrations, our Q is less than K. Remember that when Q is less than K, because K is the goal of a reaction, this means that Q needs to increase. Well, if Q is going to increase, and using calcium fluoride equation as our example, if Q needs to increase in order for our reaction to reach equilibrium, that means that our system has to go to the right. Well, for insoluble salts, our system looks like this. We're looking at the dissolution of a solid salt. In this scenario, if my system needs to go to the right to reach equilibrium, that means that I'm not going to get precipitate. Another way to think about it is when Q is less than K, we are saying that our system is unsaturated, meaning I can still dissolve more of my solid in solution. Yet another way to think about it is that the concentration of my ions, in this case, the calcium and the fluoride ions, is not high enough to force the precipitate to occur. That is what we mean when we say that it's unsaturated. Our second scenario would be that Q is equal to K. In this scenario, we still would see no precipitate because at this point, our solution is saturated. Remember that KSPs are measured at the saturation point. And so if we're saying our Q equals K, it means that our solution is saturated. Again, at the saturation point, we've dissolved all of our solid in solution. And so we can't dissolve any more, but at that exact point, I've dissolved all of it. And so there would still be no precipitate for that scenario. So the only scenario that will give us precipitation is when Q is greater than K. Again, in this case, when we say that Q is greater than K, K is the goal of a reaction. It's going to keep going until it reaches K. And so that means that Q needs to decrease. The only way for Q to decrease is for our reaction to go back in the reverse direction. Remember, again, the equilibrium system we're describing is the dissolution of an insoluble salt. So if our system has to go back to the left, that's where we have the solid versus our dissociated ions on the right side. And so going back to the left means that our solution is super saturated. This is when precipitates form. In other words, we have more ions in solution than we would at the saturation point, and so that will form precipitation. So we're looking for Q to be greater than K. The exact problem we're going to work is here. Again, here's our balanced equation that we're working with. And I have the word optional here because for purposes of showing work, writing the double replacement reaction isn't really necessary. Because we're working with equilibrium systems, the key equation that I need to work with and start with is actually the dissolution of my insoluble salt. So if lead to chloride were to precipitate, remember that some of it would dissociate back into the ions, and so this is the equilibrium system I need to work with. Now here, I know that I'm calculating a Q because I've been given a K and I'm given concentrations of my substances. So my setup for Q is going to be lead ion concentration to the first order, chloride concentration is second order. And so in order to plug values in, I need to interpret the information that's given here with my substances. So recognize that for HCl, I'm told that this is 0.015 molar, and that lead to nitrate is 0.012 molar. So what I need to figure out now is if HCl has that concentration, I need to know what is the concentration of chloride in it. So if HCl is 0.015 molar and this dissociates in a 1-to-1 ratio, then I know that hydrogen and chloride are both going to be the same concentration. So I now know my chloride concentration in solution. And then we do the same thing for our lead to nitrate discussion. So realize that this is going to dissociate into one lead ion and two nitrate ions. So if my original salt is 0.012 molar, then lead is 0.012 molar, but nitrate is 0.024 molar. Well, it's the lead ion I'm worried about and need to use, so that is going to be the same concentration as my initial salt. So my value for Q is going to be calculated as the concentration of lead times the concentration of chloride squared. When we plug that in, we get a Q value of 2.7 times 10 to the minus 6. And again, comparing our values, I technically only even need to look at the exponents, but I'll write the full value down here. So we see Q is 2.7 times 10 to the minus 6, K is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 5. Again, just looking at the exponents, we see that K is larger than Q. So again, that means for this system, Q needs to increase in order to reach equilibrium. Our equilibrium system, again, is the dissociation of the lead to chloride, the insoluble salt. So if Q needs to increase to reach equilibrium, that means that my equilibrium system needs to shift to the right. That is where the dissociated ions are, and so this is where I get no precipitate. So even though we predict one to form as a product of our double replacement reaction, it won't happen here because of our Q value, because of the concentration of the ions in solution. In the slides, I left the full workup here just for your summary, but of course we worked through it on the previous slide.